My name is Pat Ryan. Welcome to Chicago Founder Stories here at 1871, Chicago's new digital startup hub. Great crowd tonight for Jason Fried, the founder of Basecamp, formerly known as 37 Signals. Great to have you here, Jason.
Thanks for having me here.
So this is an exciting one because you know, your story has so many interesting twists, but for those who may not know Basecamp, formerly known as 37 Signals, yeah. You know, what is it? How would you best describe it to the uninitiated?
The company or yeah, the product?
Company.
My mic's on, by the way? Yeah. The company, you know, we're a small company, 42 people. And we've been making over the years, we made a lot of products.
I think when I first met you, it was six, so that's
probably
a lot of growth, you know?
It's a lot of growth, but we've been doing this for 15 years. So we've been around for quite a while, and now we're finally at 42. And we make Basecamp, which is a project management tool, helps people kind of work on things together, make progress together, no matter if you're an internal team or working with clients and that sort of thing. But our fundamental focus on when we make products is to make things that are simpler than everybody else, that underdo the competition rather than trying to outdo, and just deliver a baseline set of features that really works well, and then we kind of get out of your way. So we're not all about really complex things and really complex problems. We like to solve simple problems and try and do it well.
Well, I always say you guys do a great job, but simplicity, the other side of complexity, you do it.
It's a core thing, and it has to run all the way through. So the company's structure is simple, the way people work at the company is simple, and that churns out a simpler product. I think if you have a complicated company, it's harder to make a simple product.
I want to come back to that because that's a really profound thing we've talked about, and I think it's interesting. For the uninitiated, can you all hear us back all right? Okay, back there, great. For the uninitiated, how would you size this? I mean, I think you have tens of millions of...
Yeah, there's about 15 million people have Basecamp accounts.
Wow.
Basecamp logins. And there's hundreds of thousands of companies that use Basecamp. So it's a pretty big scale,
yeah.
Quite a big thing. But it's grown completely organically. So we don't do any advertising. We don't have a marketing department. We've maybe spent in 15 years less than $100,000 advertising. So it's just a matter of building something good, being around for a long time, and people spreading the word about it because they like it. And that's how we've always done it. And we've experimented. We've thought about doing advertising and stuff, but we just never have. So it's all organic growth.
Well, a lot of entrepreneurs out there are envious. We'll get to that because they
yeah.
want to figure out
how that works.
How to make that work. So let's just go back a little bit. We'll kind of go back before we come forward.
Okay.
You know, the idea for Basecamp, which is obviously not only your cornerstone product, but now your company name. Where did the idea come from?
Basecamp as a product came from us. We were originally a web design company, and we were doing work for hire for web design. So companies would hire us to redesign their site or make a site for them. And we started the company in 99, got really busy in 2002, 2003, and we were basically managing projects like a lot of people still do today, which is via email. Right, they would be sending an email back and forth. We'd deliver work via email, and it's fine. But at a certain point, especially long-running projects, it turns into kind of a mess, right?
Right.
People don't know who saw what and what the latest version of this is and the whole thing, right? So
yep.
We looked around at the time at project management software, and it was not solving the problems that we had. We didn't have problems where we needed to broadcast project schedules or make Gantt charts or numbers, and it was more about, we need to talk to our client, deliver stuff, and get feedback, and know where they stand, and know where we stand, and have stuff on the record, that kind of stuff. So we couldn't find something, so we built something for ourselves. But we didn't really know that it was going to be a product at the time. It was just, we need something to run our own project management. And it turned out that once we built it for ourselves in a few months, we started using it with clients that we had. And they really liked it, and they said, what is this thing? And we said, it's this thing we made. I don't know, it's this thing. It didn't have a name, it's just this thing. And so, you know, we kept hearing that, and then the light bulb goes on, you're like, maybe there's something here, let's turn it into a product and see what happens. And so it turned out that we put some prices on it, which we just guessed at, and,
Did you call it Basecamp at first?
It was called Basecamp when we launched it. Yeah, but...
Where'd the name come from? I know you don't have a marketing department.
No. I mean, I come up with all the names for the products that we've done. I just like naming things, it just pops into my head. Like if I think about it too hard, I'll never come up with a name. And once you pull the thesaurus out, you're screwed. You can't pull the thesaurus out when you're trying to name a company. It just doesn't work. The idea is that, fundamentally, is that projects are journeys. And, you know, you need to sort of stop along the way and come together. And that's kind of what a base camp is, like if you're climbing a mountain.
That's cool.
You climb, you stop, you set up camp, you relax, you talk, whatever. Then you go back, do your work, which is climbing, and set up. So it's kind of like that.
That's cool.
But, you know, it's not really that literal, but that's kind of where the idea came from.
That's great.
Yeah.
So we'll get a chance to talk more about, you know, what the company's become and where you've been of late and the name change and everything else. But
yeah.
Just take us back originally. You know, where are you from?
Mm-hmm.
What kind of things did you like doing as a kid? Where were there early things that you say, boy, I guess my neighbor would have thought I'd be an entrepreneur watching that or a designer or whatever?
All right. I'm from Deerfield, which is a suburb of Chicago. I mean, technically, I was born in the city where I was about two. My parents moved out to Deerfield, and I grew up out there. I got my first computer. My first computer was a Mac SE, which is probably 87, maybe. I don't know, 86, 87, something like that. But before that, I got interested in design because my dad is an investor, stock trader. And he would get...
So just the average person here is not going to put together your dad being involved in the financial markets and design.
Nothing to do with design. But every quarter or year, I don't remember what it was, this big package would show up. Many big packages would show up in the mail. They were heavy. And I would look at them, and my dad would open them, and it was an annual report for one of the companies that he had invested in.
Yeah.
This is back when they used to print these things out, right? And they were like, you know, thick.
Like magazines.
They were beautiful. So they're glossy, well laid out. Well, typeset was great, beautifully typeset. Nice pieces of design. And that's the first time I ever remember seeing something like that and like understanding that this was designed by a human. And I was like, that was really cool. And I just started to like leaf through them. I didn't know what I was looking at. I didn't know the tables and that stuff. But I liked how it was organized and it looked good and someone clearly thought about it. And that's how I got interested in design, by looking at annual reports.
Not obvious, but okay.
Yeah, it's just...
That's great.
Yeah, so I got into that, and I'm like,
And that poor corporate designer in the design department has no idea what he or she inspired.
Yeah, right.
How great.
It was a cool time, I think, for that stuff. And I looked at that, and I started getting into that, and then I finally got a computer, and then I learned just
roughly... So what was your first computer?
Mac SE. Black and white, and 9-inch screen, the Mac SE. And I learned, I remember I saw my neighbor to the Goldens, was their last name, they had a Mac SE also. It was the first time I'd ever seen one, and they had Flight Simulator on it.
Oh, cool.
Which was awesome. It was like really crisp and really cool, and I remember telling my parents I wanted one of those. And they said, you have to make a list of 100 reasons why you should have a computer. And so I made up 100 bullshit reasons. Like most of them were about like studying and doing better in school and all that stuff. And eventually I got one. And I kind of messed around and learned how to make things with Mac Draw and Mac Paint and some of the things that were out at the time. And before there was Photoshop, there's something called Aldus something, and there was PageMaker. I just kind of messed around, like made my own fake logos for companies that didn't exist and made my own fake annual reports and just kind of messed around.
You had clients?
I had fake clients, yeah.
You really did.
Fake clients are easy because they don't talk back, which is nice. But they don't pay their bills, so that's not.
And you didn't need a project management because they didn't communicate.
They didn't. Whatever I delivered, was they were happy with.
So how much backstory on when the logos and the companies did you have? Was it, how vivid was your imagination on those?
I just made stuff. I just made up company names, I think, and made up logos. And they weren't good because I didn't know what I was doing, but... it was practice for me, and I just started to learn the tools and learn the trade, really. And that's how that happened.
And how old were you?
I'm turning 40 this year. This was 87, 13, is that right?
Yeah.
Something like that.
Sounds about right.
Born in 74, 13, something like that. And I got into that, and I started learning how to do that stuff, and I got to make things for the first time in my life. I was making stuff, which is cool.
And that was the early days of getting to make things, really make things, not just code things.
Yeah, this was just like pure design stuff, just messing around with like, well, there's a circle tool. I can like make a circle, make it black, and combine two circles. And there's the MasterCard logo. I'm like, oh, wow, I made that. You know, like, wow, that's cool. And you just keep getting more and more complicated, and you mess around and learn more things.
So you're doing that, and as I remember from talking to you about it, you ended up sort of backing your way into a real business of sorts.
Yes.
With this. So
Yeah.
Talk a little bit about the life of creating a board back in the day.
Yeah, so way back before the internet was around, there were these things called bulletin board systems, BBSs. Anyone here know what those were? A few people, okay. So way back in the 80s, late 80s, people would set up what was called a bulletin board system, which was like, it was running the software on their home computer, hooked up to a modem, hooked up to a phone line, and you got to dial into it, and only one person could use it at a time because the line was busy if someone was using it. But it was a place to like discuss stuff and share files, kind of like what people do today, but just really primitive. And I somehow stumbled on these things. I got a modem and stumbled onto it, I don't know. And then I decided to start my own BBS system. And it was just a place for people who like.
What was yours about? Because they had to have a theme, right?
They had a theme, yeah. Mine was about Macs, like
perfect
Macintosh. I don't know
what
it was about, really, but that's what it was about. And we talked about, people talked about, like, new software that was coming
out.
What was it called?
Great,
I think it was called Mad Max.
Mad Max.
Yeah.
There you go.
With a C.
Yeah,
yeah,
right.
Mad Max, yeah. All right, so.
It was the 80s.
It was the 80s. It worked.
Absolutely.
So I did that.
So what kind of traffic did you get?
You know, I don't remember. I don't remember the traffic, but I remember the line being busy a lot, which is good. Like, I remember, so I had it in my room, and I remember that, you know, when someone dials in, you hear that modem sound.
Right.
You guys know the modem sound. And so that was like a reminder that people were using this thing. Like, oh my God, someone just called, and someone just called, and someone just called. And that was just a cool, it's like a cash register sound, you know, in a small shop, I imagine.
Right,
but it's
yeah.
a modem sound. And like, people are using this thing that I made. I don't know what it is, like why or how they found it, but somehow they did. And it was cool to see, it was an early introduction to online interface design for me. Because I had to design this thing, and all I had was text. That's right. all there was. So I like designed prompts and designed what the message board output would look like, what a message would look like, what comments would look like.
So this is interesting. For those of you who obviously you know Jason is a great designer, and there was a lot of really great insights into how to create design in a really powerful way. But we talked about this, and you had a great saying. I think it'd be great to hear if everybody understand, which is you talked about. Essentially painting by typing.
Yeah.
Talk about what you mean by that. And you talked about this having a big influence on what this has all become.
Yeah, I think so.
Because most people look and say there's nothing to design with.
Yeah, I mean, it was basically a text. Imagine if you just had a text editor, whatever it was, you know, Word or whatever you got, right? Google Docs, whatever it is. And like that piece of paper is, and 26 characters roughly, is like all you have to design something that people can log into and look at and comment on and stuff. And that's like all you had. Everything has an interface. And so like, so I just had a few characters. And then eventually there were these like, the software grew up a bit where you could use what was called ANSI characters, which were like, there's another character set that had like corners and filled in boxes and different colors. And you can start to do that stuff. And so I just learned, like, I had a very limited tool set. And I just learned how to like draw lines with text and draw boxes with text and color things in with text and make like bigger type with text and just learned how to do all that stuff. It's all I had.
So when we talk about constraints catalyzing creativity, you had a ton of constraints.
Like 26 characters basically, maybe 40, and that was it.
And what did that teach you that you think has carried through and grown with what you've done?
I think it's that there's probably a bunch of lessons that I don't realize, but I think one of them was that you don't need much. Like it doesn't need to be, I think, like, for example, today, I think web design has gotten way out of control, too slick, too fancy. I was looking today at, we're interviewing people for a new design position at Basecamp. And this, I always ask people, like, what inspires you? What's interesting? And this one guy goes, recently I just saw the first website ever, which is Tim Berners-Lee's first website, like, announcing the World Wide Web. And it's still online. And you can go to it, and it's just text and blue links. And it's 25 years old, and it's the best it could be. Like it does, if it was high, like more designed, it would be worse. It's beautiful that it just is what it is. It's just text and links. And I think that sometimes designers forget that this is about communication and what's the simplest way to do that and the clearest way to do that. And usually, it's just really good words, mm-hmm. More so than really fancy designs.
The word piece too, because you talked about painting by typing, which I think is a really profound idea from a design perspective, but also, having only 26 characters, words become an important part of the design.
Totally. And that stuck with me. I still believe that words are design and probably more important than the visual side of things. I always tell people, if you have a budget to redesign your website, you're better off rewriting it first. Like, if you rewrite your website, you'll probably have more results than if you redesign it. Because if you redesign it and the words are bad, people just still don't understand what you're talking about. And a lot of people don't know how to write and can't be clear about things. So anyway, all we had was words back then. So like how I named a prompt or how I explained how something worked, whatever it is all words. And that reminded me, and I still think that that's the most important thing today. But that's all I had back then.
Well, it's interesting. We met through a mutual friend, Jim Kudal,
yeah.
Used to office with, great guy.
Uh-huh.
And he's a big believer in, you know, you've got to get the words.
Oh, he's a great copywriter.
He really is.
And I think it's just such it's almost, it's the last thing that most people care about, which is when they're making something, are the words, unfortunately. I think it should probably be the first thing.
Well, the word, you're right, the word design has been thought about to be like visual design and thinking of copy as a separate discipline almost.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, you're right. Jim, one of the things, first things he did for us was he had an idea for our first company, and it was like, what we should do to announce this product is we should do like a movie poster.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, simple, like a sunset over a mountain, like a sunrise over a mountain of something dawning come. Really simple visual, and just these words, destiny chooses the first to look. And it was like, that was the name.
Okay.
And it was just the words really set.
Yeah.
And so we did it, and he did a great job with it, as he always does. Yeah, he did a lot of fun things.
He's great.
But people hung that in their office walls.
Uh-huh.
You know?
Yeah.
And you're like, it's marketing for a trade show.
Right,
you know?
Right.
But the words were so profound, and the visual image was simple yet profound.
Yeah.
And it had a huge impact. And, you know, people try and beat it by adding more.
Yeah.
And it's that whole great design is really taken away.
Yeah. I think words are also, they're very accessible. You don't have to be a great artist to design something well if you know how to write something well.
Right.
And I think that's just a really important point. So I learned that way back, and I've been practicing it really for like 30 years or whatever now, I guess.
Well, so talk about where you took that, because you have a venture into FileMaker Pro, which I think FileMaker, by the way, is the first, wasn't the first Groupon app built on? Was it?
Oh, was it?
I think it was.
Wouldn't surprise me.
I think it was like a prototype to see if it was really good.
I can see that.
Product.
I can see that. Yeah, FileMaker Pro, for those of you who don't know, is just a visual database tool, basically, and it's been around for a long time, and it lets you make databases like a contact database or music collection database or whatever it is really, really fast without having to know how to program. There's some scripting in it if you want to get there, but you don't have to. You can like drag this field on and drag that field on and drag this search field. You know, it just all the stuff was like pre-configured. It was almost like HyperCard, for those of you who remember that, but it was even simpler and more powerful, actually. Anyway, so I discovered that at some point, and I realized that I could make graphical interfaces with this, and I could make things functional. Before, I only knew how to make like logos, which aren't functional. But now I could make a logo that did something when you clicked it, or I could make an interface that allowed you to enter text in a certain way, and it would do something. It would like, keep a record, and I could search it and call it up later and sort and all that stuff. So I you know, like I've always done, I'm like, what do I need? What do I need? And at the time, I had a bunch of CDs and tapes and stuff. I'm like, I need a way to catalog these things so I know what I have. So when I loan something out to a friend, I know who has it, and so I know how to get it back. So I made a FileMaker Pro database for that called, I eventually called it AudioFile.
Some people have a hard time imagining that we traded albums
did.
And CDs and
yeah, you traded
tapes.
Stuff.
Yeah.
And you're like, my 15 friends have different things. Like, you know, I had to find, like, I had to buy these things at some point. I want them back, you know? Now you don't have to do any of that, but that's what it was like back then. And so, So I made this thing, and I made it for myself again, and then I went on AOL before the internet was around, really. The internet was around, but not commercially. Early 90s, I went on to AOL, and you could do searches from the file section for like cataloging programs. And I downloaded a few music ones. This is before I built the one. I downloaded a few of them, hated them all. They were just complicated and weird and just didn't work for me. So I made my own, and then I put mine up there, and I said, if you like this, send me $20.
One of the questions on here is, who's your first customer? I think most people assume it was a 37 Signals customer.
My first customer that I remember was from Germany. I never met the person, but one summer after I put this thing up on AOL, I was living at home because I was like, I don't know, 15 or 16, whatever it was, I don't know. And there's this envelope that came in the mail. It was an airmail envelope with like the blue and red checks along the top. If you guys remember those, maybe they still have them, probably do. Anyway. My mom's like, you got a letter from Germany. I'm like, I don't know anybody in Germany.
Yeah, a little suspicious.
Yeah, like, what's going on, you know? I'm like, is there a Porsche in there? No. Damn it. I opened it, and it was a printout of the screen for the software with a $20 bill, and someone wrote, like, love your software, thank you. And so someone actually paid $20 for the software. And that was the first time that I realized that I could make something. It wasn't hard for me to make. I could make it, I could make it well, and I could charge for it. And over the following few years, I probably made tens of thousands of dollars, $20 at a time, people just sending me money for this thing that they liked. And it taught me a very valuable lesson that you don't have to give stuff away for free all the time. People are happy to pay for things they enjoy and they like. And there's lots of competition that was free at the time and all that stuff. But people liked mine enough to pay $20 for it. And I actually met some of the customers I had, I'm still in touch with.
Really?
Yeah, some people. But most of them, no, I never met. But a few of them I have. And it was a great lesson for me.
Yeah,
and it gave me a lot of spending cash in college, ultimately. And it was fun.
Now, you talk about, it's an interesting thing. Obviously, you were an innovator, you were an entrepreneur, you were a designer at a very young age. But you didn't really pursue much of this in high school or college academically.
No.
Why that choice?
Well, we didn't have many class. Like, in college, I majored in finance, so I did have some business background there. But in high school, we had one class called Intro to Business. And it was more of like how to use a checkbook and that kind of stuff. It wasn't really anything to do, like, to really learn there at the time. And I took a few art classes at some point, but it wasn't like design, it was just like basic art stuff. And then I went to college and I just wanted to graduate. I didn't really want to go. Actually, I didn't even care about graduating. My parents were paying, so I felt like I had to do it. And so I'm like, what do I know? I feel like I have a knack for business. Let me just do that and get over with. And so that's what I did.
And you were...
But I was doing business, like, in school. So
this is the thing. Most people would think of you, you know, so well known in the technology and design and innovation communities as is he an engineer? Is he did he really focus on design? But you were a business major who was a track.
Yeah, I ran track. I love design and I love business, but I really mostly love making something that I want and that I think is good.
Right.
And it turns out that, like, in the Venn diagram of those things, it's like, that's what I do today. It's a mixture of business and design and product thinking and that kind of stuff. But I think it's always been that way. I just hadn't pieced it together until I was in college.
Well, I think, you know, one of the things you described, which I really relate with, is this idea that, you know, there are engineers and there are designers, but when I asked you talking before we did this, you know, I asked you to describe, well, what are you really about? And you're like, I'm a product guy.
Yeah.
And I think too often people are like, well, what kind of product guy? Are you a coding product guy?
Yeah.
Are you a design product guy? And I think you're like, I'm a product guy.
I'm a product guy. I can design. I write my own HTML and CSS, and I know a tiny bit of Ruby. And I used to know PHP back when I had to know that. And so I know enough to make something, but I really love designing interfaces. Mm-hmm. And I really love designing a business. I think of our business as a product also. And just like our product doesn't do what everyone else's does, our business doesn't do what everyone else's does, and we don't do things the way everyone else does it. So we do it a different way, and that's a product of designing our business differently. So I love making that. I love making that thing that works, either a business or a product.
Well, we'll get more into that, but I think it's interesting. So you graduate from college, and you have
University of Arizona.
Yes.
Yeah.
There you go.
I got out of here for a while. Came back.
And as far as I can tell, it is the only time you've ever had a job working for someone else since college was right after Arizona.
I mean, I had a bunch of jobs, part-time and stuff, you know, since I've been 13. My parents forced me to work when I turned 13. That was like the earliest you could work, did all sorts of things. After college, I got a job with a guy who I was doing website design for freelance during college. And he's like, you know, I'm like, I'm graduating. He's like, come work for me. I'll give you 30 grand and you can move to San Diego. I'm like, all right, fine. I had nothing else to do. I don't want to work at a bank, like, because what my degree, I think, would have gotten me or something. Nothing against banks. I just didn't want to do it. And so I'm like, all right, I'll go to San Diego and do this web design thing. And I realized, like, pretty quickly, a couple months in maybe, that I wasn't built to do that. I wasn't built to work for somebody else. I love working with people. But I wasn't good at...
Talk about what gave
what it
gave
was.
You that. Yeah, what made that so clear to you so quickly? So much so that it shaped the rest of your trajectory.
Yeah. there were just decisions that were made that I just didn't agree with, and I'm okay with that. But I felt powerless, and that really freaked me out. And it might have been that the guy wasn't a good boss, or it might have been he was a great boss and I was a young punk. I don't know what it was. But something about it made me feel like, I don't like this. I'm not excited about this. I feel like I'm doing work I don't believe in. We're doing things for the wrong reasons. And for whatever reason that was, and I'm not going to lay that on him or me, I don't know what it was. I realized that, you know, I can do this myself. I was doing this myself in college. Mm-hmm. I was doing it myself before that. And I can do it myself after that.
And you had a model of this at home, in that your dad had sort of followed his own path.
Yeah, my dad worked for someone for a while, got out of school, worked for someone, and then followed his own path. And he always told me, if you can work for yourself, you should. I don't know if that's great advice for everybody, but it worked for me. It's probably not great advice for everybody, but he must have known that I had that in me a little bit somewhere. My grandfather was an entrepreneur. I have a little bit of that in my blood, I think.
So you leave San Diego,
mm-hmm.
Come to Chicago.
I'm back here.
Yeah. You come back, and so you don't want to work for anybody else, How do you make that work?
Well,
what year is this?
This is, so I graduated college in 96, so this is like 96 and a half, seven, something like that. I come back, I had some freelance clients that I picked up in college. I would go to certain websites, financial websites, because I was into finance. I would go into financial websites, be like, this is a good site. Actually,
this is a great business development strategy.
Do you know PC Quote? Do you remember PC
sure,
Quote?
Yeah.
So I designed PC Quote's site when I was in college. Huh. They gave me a shot to design their site, because like this was 96, 95, no one knew what the hell they were doing anyway. PC Quote was a Chicago company, and I'm like, I live in Chicago and I make websites, and like, here's a redesigned front page of your site that I made for you. I didn't say it, I did it overnight, but like, here's this thing I made for you. I think I can do good work for you.
What an interesting way of going after business. You pick a site, you basically redesign part of it.
Yeah.
You send it to them and say, if you want more.
Want more, pay me or whatever. And I didn't know what I was doing, but like it worked. And I picked up a couple clients. And then some of those clients I did a lot of projects for. Others I only did one for. But eventually, like I picked up some. So I came back to Chicago, worked out of an apartment, picked up some more clients, and kept just churning away. You know, my living expenses were low. It was just me. I didn't have an office. I worked out of my apartment. And I scraped by enough to get, and I would always price things this way. How much money do I need for the next 3 months? That's how I'm going to price this next project. Always did it that way, and I kind of still do that today. It wasn't scientific. It was like, I need $6,000 for the next 3 months. Okay, so the next project's $6,000. I'll find someone who will pay me $6,000 for the next project. That's kind of how I've always done it. We don't do that kind of work anymore because now we sell product, but that's how we always did web design too. I just kind of make up numbers based on what I needed. Eventually, though, a few years into it, I finally got a big break. Someone hired this woman named Krista Mascarella. She took a shot on me. She hired me to redesign Getty Images. Getty Images website. They had a new website called Getty One, which was Getty Images owns a bunch of stock photography houses, right, and they were building one like roof, put everything under one roof so you can do a search across everything. She really somehow found my work. She liked my work. I did some work for another company in Seattle. They were based in Seattle. I think she saw it, whatever. And I was bidding up against, like, some of these names won't matter, won't make sense because people won't know this, but Clement Mach, Sapient, like a few of these big firms, and I'm like this one guy, and she knew this. I'm like, I'm one person. And I'm like, but I knew who I was bidding against because she told me. I'm like, all right, so it's $90,000, right? And the reason I picked that number is because I wanted to hire somebody. So I'm like, what would it cost me to hire someone else, pay them a salary, and then also take a salary for myself? Again, like, what do I need to go to the next level? And I think these other guys were probably bidding a few $100,000 because it was like big firms and stuff or more, and she took a shot on me. And that changed everything for me because I got to hire my first employee who ended up staying with me for 11 years.
Wow.
And that's how I got away from just doing work for myself.
And talk about who was that person, that first employee?
His name was Matt Linderman, and he was in Chicago. He was a web designer. I really liked his work. I ran into it somehow, and we worked together for 11 years, and then he left a couple of years ago. Do you guys know Vooza? Anyone here know Vooza? It's like a prank, fake tech company. So Matt now runs Vooza. which is a fake company, V-O-O-Z-A, it's very funny. Check it out. So he does that, he's a stand-up comedian now, and we're good friends and everything, but he went off to do his own thing, he moved to New York to do the comedy thing, and he's doing great.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
So, somewhere along the way, you were working on your own, you had an employee, but somewhere out of all this came 37 Signals. Yeah. How did that come together?
So while Matt and I were working together, I did something bad, which was like I went kind of looking for jobs. Because I was curious, like, what's out there for me? I don't know. Maybe I needed validation. Maybe I needed like an ego boost. Maybe I wanted to be wanted. I don't know what it was, but I'm like, I'm going to go look for jobs just to see what's going on. So I interviewed with a few companies at the time. And one of the companies was a company called Organic Online, which is a big web design firm. They just opened their Chicago office. And I interviewed with a guy named Ernest Kim, who was the creative director there, and loved Ernest. He was awesome. Like, this guy's cool. He loved Nike. I loved Nike. Like, we're just loved design. We talked shoes. I used to sell shoes when I was younger, so like we had a lot in common. And I'm like, this guy's cool, but I don't want to work at this place. But we kept in touch. And about a year later, I was still doing my thing. I interviewed a few places, didn't like it. Went back to do my own thing with Matt. Didn't like it. Ernest shot me an email. We kept in touch. He's like, I'm done with this big company thing. I don't want to do this big company thing. I want to start my own web design firm. I'm like, okay, that's cool. I've got one. Maybe we should work together. And then we had another friend named Carlos Segura, who's a graphic designer, who's a mutual friend of both of ours. And he was a print designer, traditional print designer. He wanted to get in the web. So we're like, hey, Carlos, you want to do this thing together? And now we can have like four people in this. And he's like, yeah, let's do it. So he's in, Ernest is in, he quit his job, and then me and Matt were just doing our thing, and we all came together and started 37 Signals in August of 99.
So this is kind of the, things are really cooking.
They're cooking. Good, we had some projects. Ernest brought a few projects over with him from Organic. I don't know if that was legal or not, but he did. one of the projects was a project for HP. It was like a $330,000 website project. And from that moment on, which is on day one, we've been profitable ever since for 15 years.
Wow.
So we started profitable, and we've never not been profitable in any given year.
Not a lot of people can say that.
Yeah, I mean, we've been very fortunate. I'm not going to take credit for all that. Like, Ernest brought this big project over, and that got us kickstarted. But it reminded me that that it's just been in our blood that you got to make money, you got to be profitable as soon as you can, I think. And it's just how I like to run business, and it's more like business 101 style stuff. Anyway, that's an aside, but so we started working, doing some stuff, and then eventually Carlos left about a year in. Carlos, I don't know if anyone here knows Carlos, but Carlos, he's a Chicagoan, great guy. He has like five different businesses. He's always doing a bunch of stuff, and it's just, this was like 37 Signals is my 100%, Ernest 100%, and Carlos is 20%. So he knew it, and we knew it, so we split amicably. There was a tough conversation, but it was very cool. We bought his share back. By the way, I should mention, we all put in $30,000 each to start the business, to start 37 Signals. I had money from a client project. Ernest took some of his salary, and then Carlos had money from his other businesses, and we put that in. We pooled that together. And then when Carlos left, we gave him his money back, basically. So he was very cool about that. And then Ernest left a few years after that, maybe 2002, I think it was. He just wanted to get out of the web design business. He was like growing Nike fanatic. So he moved with his wife out to Oregon to go work for Nike. Hmm. And he's doing that today. And today he's the director of footwear innovation of all of Nike, which is like a really big thing. But he bounced around. He worked for Wieden and Kennedy for a while. He worked in a few places, then was at Nike, went somewhere else, and came back to Nike. Now he's like a big guy.
And how'd you guys come up with that name, 37 Signals?
So 37 Signals was a name that Carlos found. Carlos was watching a show on PBS called Nova. You guys probably know Nova, science show. And they were talking about the SETI project, Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence, of which there's a bunch of radio telescopes listening for signs of life. And it turned out that in 99, when this documentary was on, at that point, they'd analyzed like billions of signals in space, right? It's mostly just noise and microwave radiation stuff. But there were 37 signals that were unexplained, signs of potential intelligent life. And Carlos thought that was just really cool, like just a cool thing. We didn't have a name.
That's interesting.
The domain was available. We took it. What's really cool is a really cool story. I don't know if I've told this story before. A few years ago, So this 37 signals thing was a the recognition that there were 37 signals that were unexplained was eventually published in a paper by Carl Sagan and this other guy, now I'm forgetting his name, something Horowitz, I believe. And a few years ago, Carl Sagan's dead now, but this other guy is still alive. He heard about our company somehow, and he sent me an original abstract of that paper with 37 signals highlighted, and then wrote like a really cool note at the top.
Wow.
Which is really cool. So it's like a really cool memento.
Yeah.
And it proves that like the idea was real, because I'd never actually seen that episode of Nova. It could have been the wrong number, but it's real. But so I have that. It's a really cool piece of history that we have.
And it led to a great name for your blog.
Yeah, Signal versus Noise is where, you know, so. But it was always a cool name. It was just different. We're a different company. It led to like our first website, which is 37 ideas. It wasn't any, we didn't show any portfolio work, which is rare for a web design company. We've always done things differently than everybody else. And I just enjoy doing it that way, but it's not intentional. I just look at things and I'm like, I don't like the way that's done. I can do it a different way.
And when did you start blogging?
I think it was like 2000, maybe. I'd heard the term blog. I didn't know what it was. I'm like, what the hell is this blog? I heard about blog a few times. There was something back then, I forget the name of the product. It was written by a guy named Noah Dan. I don't remember the name of the product, but it was a really early blogging engine, which we like hooked up and like started blogging. And our blogs were like, it was more like Twitter at the time. It was like, we did these one-liners. And what we realized is we were doing this at work. We were talking to each other at work all the time. We're like, why don't we just talk out loud? Why do we need to talk at work? Let's just share these ideas with everybody. No one was out there, but let's just put them out there publicly. And that's how it all started for us, the blog. And you know, we've switched through a bunch of stuff over the years, but today it's a very popular blog. About 100,000 plus people read it every day. And,
wow.
But it's just a matter, again, of like time and repetition and discipline, and like eventually 10 years later you get 100,000 people reading something. But if you give up in 2 years, you're never gonna get 100,000 people reading something.
And how was it, is it like a power law as you move it starts to
no
move faster?
It was pretty consistent. There was a few moments when there was like some major piece that we wrote up that people really liked and they spread it out a lot, but it's been pretty consistent and it's pretty much plateaued. Like I think, you know, we measure it by a little bit by RSS readers, and that's sort of a dying thing. And you know, we have a lot more Twitter followers now than blog readers. It's like, I don't know how to measure this stuff anymore. Who knows who sees what?
And what motivated you, and what's kept you motivated to keep blogging?
I love writing, and I love sharing, and that's our only marketing. So we, like I said, we don't do any advertising or marketing really. So for us, it's sharing. It's why we write books. It's why we publish on the blog. It's why I write for Inc. magazine. It's like, it's a way for us to share and get the word out about how we feel about things and what we believe and sharing some lessons that hopefully other people can take to heart if they work for them, so they don't make the same mistakes, or they can shortcut some things so they don't have to learn it themselves. I don't know. I mean, it's just about sharing.
No, it's great.
Yeah.
People,
here's the thing. I think people respect, if you learn something from someone, I think you ultimately listen to them more rather than being like, if we had to go out and somehow advertise to 100,000 people every day, we'd be spending a lot of money, mm-hmm. and they wouldn't believe us.
Right.
But since we're writing something and sharing it with them, it's more believable because we're not paying them or we're not buying their attention. We're writing something and they think it's valuable enough to read us every day. And I think you just form a different kind of relationship. It's more of an audience relationship than it is a advertiser-consumer sort of relationship.
And how often do you write?
It depends. I write one article for Inc. every month, so there's that. In the blog, I probably publish something once every couple weeks, and then sometimes I'll go and like do three things in a week. There's no schedule, no set schedule. Anyone in the company can write. There's no one who approves anything. Just if you have something to say, you can write it on the blog. And sometimes you're prolific, and sometimes you have nothing to say. So I don't force it. The only thing I have to force is the ink piece, because it's like there's a deadline, you know.
And early on, you talked about being in a discipline. How did you ever get? Was it just really at the office conversation, or was it something that? Because you were pretty consistent, and that you see, there's some people I've really enjoyed their work, and then they got busy in their life and they stopped and they kind of lost momentum.
I don't know. It's something we just always enjoyed, and I think that I think that we're an opinionated bunch. So when you put out opinions, you get a lot of stuff back, and some of it's flack, and some people hate you, and some people love what you're saying. And so that's kind of, that's motivation and fuel in some ways. I think if you're putting stuff out that's like middle of the road, and no one really cares, it's very easy to get demoralized. But when you know that you're striking a chord with some people, it's more engaging and interesting, I think, to keep doing it. So I think that's what, in some ways, keeps you going. And then once you have an audience, you have a, you feel an obligation, at least I do, to write good things and to share good things with them.
Right. Well, you do a great job of that.
Thank you.
I really enjoy it. The but let's go back for a minute, because it's 2003 or 2002. You started a web design firm. Your partners have both left. Talk about where you were and you know, was that hard at all? And how did, what were those next moves? Because the next moves are obviously some of the really important ones in the story.
I was sort of getting sick of clients, like client work. I wasn't enjoying it. Like, you do a big project, you pass it off, it doesn't get implemented the way you thought. People here, I'm sure, know that, who are in that business. And eventually, it gnaws at you, and you're like, yeah, this is not satisfying for me. And so I started thinking about making products for a while. I'm like, well, we could make these custom, like, we're making, like, maybe we could make a blog for people who are going on a trip, and they could write up their travels and share it with their friends, and I don't know, this is, like, really early. But we didn't do any of that, and we just kept doing client work, because that's what paid the bills.
But you were thinking product.
Thinking a little bit about product, because I remember my FileMaker days, when I enjoyed making a product, and you make a product, and it's your opinions, and you put it out there, and then people can buy it or they don't, compared to client work, where you're basically being told what, ultimately, you're being told what to do. Mm-hmm. I just, like, you know, I was thinking product again, but we didn't know what to do, and I don't know. I just kept doing work, and we just got busier and busier and busier, and we needed some way to manage the projects, and that's how that whole
you
thing links up.
You get busier and busier and busier with work you weren't really that into anymore.
Well, we started doing a whole new thing, so I'm surprised the industry has not really taken this on as an idea, because I think it's a great idea and it worked really well for us. I realized at a certain point that one of the reasons client work sucks is because it's a bad deal. So a client, you pitch a client on this big project, they are already nervous. They would have to put up 50, 60, 70, 100 grand, whatever. They're not going to get, they don't know what they're buying. It's going to take 6 months to do it. Like, that's a shitty deal. Like, that's not something a lot of people are happy about going into. And I wasn't happy about it because it was just weird. I don't like those big, long projects. They end up, it's just boring. Anyway, so we launched this thing called 37 Express, which was I'm like, I don't want to do big projects anymore. I want to do small projects. I want to do one-page projects. Hmm. So the deal was, you hire us to do one page on your site, $3,500. We'll deliver it in a week. There's nothing to talk about. So it's not about, there's no revisions.
So you almost made it a product.
I made web design a product.
Huh.
And it started getting really popular. So what people would say is, like, hey, you know, I'd be like, you don't need a whole site redesign. You just, like, someone needs to look at your search results page or your shopping cart page or your home page. Like, let's do a page at a time. You'll get it in a week. You know exactly what you're getting. You know how much it's going to cost, and you know we're going to get it. And you really know these things. And it started lighting up. Like, a lot of people started buying these things from us. So we were doing dozens of these things, which was when we got it busy because we were just four people at the time. So doing dozens of these things was difficult. And that's when we really needed to manage these things. That's how that happened. And then we were still doing some longer-term client projects, but we turned web design into a product. The product became popular.
And how big you were a pretty good-sized web design business for...
I think we were probably doing maybe $1 million a year at that point. You know, but we've been around for 5 years.
That's a lot of $3,500 projects.
Yeah. Well, they weren't all that. So we had a few big ones. And then quantity-wise, though, we were doing a lot of these smaller ones. We had maybe three, four big ones a year. Couple hundred grand or something each. I don't know what it was. And then, like, we did a bunch of these small ones.
Got it.
Small ones were fun because we got to solve a very specific problem. We got to deliver it on Friday. And then we didn't have to hear from the client ever again. And that was awesome. Unless they wanted another page. And then we would do another page for $3,500. And, you know, I still believe that that's a great model. And I think the client services industry should adopt that and think a little bit more about productizing their work in that way. Because I don't think everybody needs big, huge, massive redesigns and massive projects all the time.
No, I mean, as a client, you do say to yourself, you're kind of getting married for this whole big project, and you don't know.
You don't know. I mean, it's and you really don't know how long it's going to take, and you really don't know how much it's going to cost, and you really don't know what you're buying, you really don't know what you're going to get. So make it a week, $3,500. If you like it, we'll do another one. If you don't, that's fine. And maybe you just need one page. So anyway, that's how that happened.
So then you work on Basecamp as a project. And I'd love you to talk for a minute about, you built Basecamp for yourselves.
Yes.
And talk about why you think that was important.
Yeah, and this is how I've always done everything. So audio file, that FileMaker Pro thing to collect music was for me. Basecamp was for me. I made something before that called Single File, which is a book collection thing. That was for me. The reason why is because I think that you just know when it's good enough. And that's an important point. You know when it's good enough. Because if you're building something for somebody else, you're always guessing. You're trying to read their mind, they're telling you this, but everything gets lost in translation a little bit. It's like a game of telephone. They tell you one thing and you interpret it a different way. And you can never feel, you have to feel through someone else, and that's just hard. It's very hard to do. It's possible, but very hard to do. But when you build something for yourself, you know when you're done, because you know when it works and it solves the problem that you had or does the job that you're hiring it to do, and you're like, it's done. And that's how we built Basecamp. We had a problem, we knew what we needed to do, and we knew when it was done. And we didn't go off and imagine all the other things it could do, because we didn't need all those other things. We knew exactly what we needed. And so I think that you can judge quality at a much more precise level. You're not judging it by proxy, you're judging it because you're using it. I think it's more satisfying, and I think that you're more excited about it, and you do better work that way, personally.
There's no question, we do better product work when it's a problem we can relate to.
We can relate to.
Yeah, totally.
Question.
So you're a web design firm, you're very successful, but you're a services business, trying to productize some of the things in there. You got this product that goes out there. Talk about that transition, because they're two totally different kind of companies.
Yeah.
Talk about that transition, how it went, what was it like?
We didn't know it was going to happen. We thought that, so we made this Basecamp thing, we're like, all right, this is a product, we called it Basecamp, we polished it up, we threw some prices on it that we thought were reasonable, $19, $39, $59, and $79. Like, this is a subscription service, there were very few at the time, we were really early. This is 2004, 10 years ago. There was, I don't know, hardly any SaaS. SaaS wasn't a term, no one knew. Subscription software is a subscription, not many people thought about that. So we did that, threw it out there, announced it on our blog to 2,000 readers. And we had this thing in mind that we weren't thinking about switching from service yet. I just knew I didn't like service. We're like, all right, if Basecamp makes $5,000 a month after the first year, so ultimately you'd be doing $60,000 a year, like, that's a nice, that's like 5% of our income. It'd be like a nice side thing. It'd be killer. We need it anyway, so why not? It turned out that it was doing $5,000 a month in about 6 weeks. And so we realized we're onto something here. Like, this is real. And then it just kept steady growth. It's grown every quarter since then. And like, the last quarter's the best quarter we've ever had, and hopefully the next one. I mean, at a certain point, it might not be, but so far it's been great for 10 years. And but we didn't know, and it took about a year or so for it to be generating more money than our services business. And at that moment,
still pretty fast.
Yeah, it was fast. There's nothing else like it at the time. It was fresh. It was different. It was fairly priced, and it made sense. We understood the market. It was good. Good fit all around. And then about a year and a half, it was making more money. So we stopped doing client services in 2005. And have not taken on one of those since, and we became a software company at that point.
And what did you always take that lesson of build something for yourself as other products, or
always?
Were there times where you feel like you had to be pulled back to?
There's times, and there's still times today, even when we make something, a feature or something that we know we're never going to use, and we have to imagine how other people are going to use it, and we're never happy with it. And it's always the most complicated code in the product and always the most complicated interface in the product because we don't know. We don't know when enough is enough. We have to imagine things. And so when we built HiRise in 2007, which is our CRM tool, we threw it out after 6 months because we'd built it and we were imagining, wouldn't it be cool if? And wouldn't it be cool if? And whenever you run into the wouldn't it be cool if, you're in trouble, I think. Some of those are okay, but too many in a row,
right?
You're guessing. And we're like, this sucks. We're not going to use this thing. So we threw it out and started over. So we lost 6 months of time on that, but it was a great decision because we said, all right, why do we want to build this in the first place? Oh, yeah.
How hard was it to get the team on board to
throw it out?
Yeah.
It was a small team. It was just me and David at the time. We both knew. It sucks to throw out work, but it sucks even more to ship crappy work.
Right.
That's worse because you have to live with that for a long time. And like the public, you have to have the wrath of the public in that way. Throw stuff out and no one knows about it, that's fine. I'm like, what are we building this for? Oh yeah, I want to keep track of the people I talk to. I want to know what they said and what I said. And I want to know what I need to follow up next. That is all HiRISE does when we launched it, because it's exactly what we needed. It wasn't like, well, I could do this and fancy stuff and whatever. It's just like that. And so we got back to that basics, and that became a very successful product for us.
So one of the things that you've adopted that we're big believers in as well, you know, is this Clay Christensen jobs to be done. And I think that was when you and I reconnected, was after talking about that. Explain for a minute for people who are the uninitiated,
yeah,
what it is and why you think that's been an important thing for you all.
There's this idea Clay Christensen came up with. Clay Christensen's Harvard Business School professor, author, Innovator's Dilemma, Solution, a variety of books.
Yeah. Probably the best thinker about innovation.
Amazing. An amazing man. Amazing person. He has this idea
called... He was an entrepreneur before his business school professor.
I didn't know that, actually.
Yeah. He actually... I had him speak here at YPO Chicago, and he actually was interesting. He said, at 40, he'd been an entrepreneur with an... He'd an MIT guy.
Mm-hmm.
But CEO of a company, he said, because he was the least technical of the
That's what happens.
And he went to Harvard Business School at 40, and they said, he wanted to get a PhD, and they said, no one's going to hire you, you're too old.
Uh-huh.
And of course, he's gone on to become one of the world's great thinkers on this.
And Harvard hired him, which is the best part.
Yes, yes, exactly. Which
no one's going to hire you, except we will, 10 years from now. Brilliant man. And anyway, he has this idea called jobs to be done, mm-hmm, which is that... people don't buy a product to solve a problem. Mm-hmm. They hire a product to do a job. Just like you hire an employee to do a job, you hire a product to do a job. And his whole thing is you have to understand what the job is that people are hiring your product to do, and then build around the job, not around the problem. And the best way to illustrate this is one of the other old Harvard School business professors had this saying that, I'm going to botch this, but something like, buy the drill, they buy the hole, something
right.
like that.
Yeah, people don't need a three-quarter inch bit, they need a three-quarter inch hole.
Right, there you go. So the idea is that the drill manufacturers think people are buying drills.
Right.
No. People need a hole in the wall. And so that's what they're finding something they can hire to do that job, to put a hole in the wall. There's a lot of other ways to put a hole in the wall. You can just get a nail and a hammer and hit it hard enough, you can get a hole in the wall. Maybe there's like an auger or one of those things you can get.
Right.
There's a lot of other ways to get a hole in the wall. So if you're just a drill manufacturer and you think your only competition are drills, you're wrong.
Yep.
You got to think about all the other things.
Well, our friends from Rewired, who I connected with through you,
yeah,
they did the famous milkshake story where they realized that half the milkshakes at McDonald's were sold at breakfast, and they went and they did the anthropological watch, see everybody what they do, and all those people were alone. They bought just a milkshake, they didn't buy anything else, and they all left the restaurant. And so the next day they said, I noticed you bought a milkshake yesterday, which is creep somebody out at 6:30 in the morning.
Yeah.
And they're like, you're watching what I get for breakfast?
Yeah.
And it was always because they were drinking on the commute. They wanted to fill their belly up. It was interesting. It kept it going.
Yeah.
And it's amazing because McDonald's thought that milkshakes were a dessert item, and they were trying to figure out, how do I sell more milkshakes to kids at dinner?
Yeah.
Meanwhile, there's a market for adults. And so it's an incredibly powerful thing. Talk a little bit about when you redid Basecamp, you did this. You guys obviously always had a good sense of this. What was it that it allowed you to do?
Well, what we learned, and we haven't fully executed on this, but what we learned, which is really interesting, was that we did these interviews. It's a whole interview style. It's very interesting. You don't talk about the product at all. You talk about the story. You talk to customers, find out what was going through their head when they made this purchase and what was going on in their head a year before that. And anyway, it's very interesting way of line of questioning. Anyway, what we found out was that a lot of people use Basecamp not to manage projects, but to cover their ass. And the job they hire Basecamp to do is to have is to put something on the record. So if they ever have, if they're ever sued by a client, they can go back and point and said, you approve this, right? That pattern came out of these interviews, and we had no idea that that's why, and it's not the only reason, so we don't want to change our marketing to be like, don't get sued. But, maybe we should talk about it more, or maybe we should pitch that more. I don't know, but it's very interesting. And, you know, we thought about that, and what was interesting about it, though, was that none of the people who were afraid of being sued had ever actually been sued, but they were afraid of being sued. And they wanted stuff on the record. They wanted a paper trail. And that's why they used Basecamp.
Interesting.
And they put all the stuff that was important about the project and the deal in Basecamp because they knew it would be safe there. And then they could always point to it. So Basecamp was the thing to point at, which is just very interesting. And you would never get at that if you talked about the features. Tell me about how you use messages. Tell me about how you use files. Tell me about how, whatever. Because that's not the story. The story is being afraid of getting sued, and the only way to get there is to ask different kinds of probing questions about what was going on in their head and why they did something at a certain time and who they're working with, and then eventually these patterns emerge. And you're like, oh my God, that's why they're using.
You know, it's interesting. One of the things you learn as a product person is that it also gives you a sense if you don't do this, you could end up with really unhappy customers. So we had a woman who was when we did the training, who was the sort of example interview, and she bought a nice camera for a trip. But what she learned is that she really did it to buy a camera to take pictures to give. She wanted to give her family those books at Christmas.
Uh-huh.
And she actually learned she wanted to give her family better books than her sister-in-law had the year before.
Uh-huh. Totally.
And she hated her camera because she couldn't get the pictures into the book.
Uh-huh.
And it's a really interesting thing, which is she bought the wrong camera. She spent the wrong. Everything was wrong about it. And she became a negative person about her product because, you know, she'd gone with like what camera aficionados said would be the best camera.
Yeah.
And it's this whole way of thinking about why people have it and how you make them fulfilled.
Yeah.
And it's really powerful. I think it's underappreciated in software design.
I think so, too. Can I give you another quick example? Did Bob ever tell you about the Snickers and Milky Way thing?
No.
This is super fascinating. So he was hired by Mars many, many years ago. Snickers and Milky Way, part of the same company, they were trying to compete head-to-head. Mars or Snickers is trying to beat Milky Way. Milky Way is trying to beat Snickers, right? And it turns out that, and by the way, they're both candy bars. So both candy bar groups think they're competing because we make a candy bar, so we're competing with candy bars. Turns out that Snickers and Milky Way do not compete at all. Milky Way is eaten mostly by women, alone. It's very interesting. People will get in, and they did a whole series of interviews. People will go get a Milky Way and hide like in their car. Or like they'll go in a room and close the door, and a Milky Way is like a dessert. It's an indulgence. It's I had a shitty day. Like I need to treat myself. Okay, a Snickers is not that. Snickers is a meal replacement, mostly eaten by men who are on the go. Who are like I'm gonna be exhausted in 20 minutes. I got a meeting. Like I'm just gonna wolf this Snickers bar down. When they're in the candy aisle. Someone who's after a meal replacement will never look at Milky Way, and someone who's after dessert and indulgence will never look at Snickers. They don't compete at all. Milky Way competes with ice cream, milkshakes, cake. Snickers competes with power bars, all these things. And so the jobs are very different. One is like, make me feel good after a crappy day, and the other one's like, give me energy I need. Very it's different things. And so you could hire, instead of hiring a Milky Way, you could hire ice cream. Or you could hire a cake.
Who's your competitive
set? Exactly. The competitive set is very different once you start thinking this way. And it's fascinating.
It is amazing. Well, that's
you'd be so surprised. One quick thing, too. We did this. We did some interviews around mattresses at one point because we were curious. Turns out mattresses compete with whiskey.
This should be a good one.
Yeah, so right. So a lot of mattresses compete with mattresses. Well, really, mattresses compete with a good night's sleep. And a lot of people drink themselves to sleep. And so some people who feel like they're getting uncomfortable night's sleep will actually drink themselves to sleep instead of buying a new mattress because it's easier to drink than it is to get a new. So it's very interesting, all these competitive sets when you start thinking about the job. The job is get a good night's sleep. It's not buy a mattress. And it's a very different way of thinking. It's fascinating.
Yeah, it really is. It's powerful.
It is.
It's powerful. I have to say, I don't hear enough about it in people designing products, and I think our products would be so much better.
I think so too. There's some great examples now, but there's fewer. Yeah. One thing I've seen at like Walgreens, they have sometimes there's a new brand they have called Nice, which is I think their white label brand or whatever. And instead of saying like pain reliever, it's like I've got a headache, or you know, I need fresh breath instead of saying mouthwash. Like things like that that are like more job based. I don't know if they're doing well, but it's an interesting angle.
It is interesting. Yeah. It is. So one of the things I know people love to hear about, I always find interesting, is your partner now in the business, David. Mm-hmm. Talk about how you guys started working together, a little bit of that evolution, because I think you guys have done a lot together, very high profile, but go back to kind of how it all started and how that relationship works.
Today, yeah, David was a reader of our blog back in early 2000s, and I was learning how to write PHP, and I was stuck. I got as far as I could. I was reading this book, and I like copied the book and like did as much as I could, and then I'm like, I don't know how to do anything else. So I posted something on our blog about pagination, like how do I go to the next 50 pages or something like that. And I got a lot of emails back, but David's was the most helpful and the most thoughtful.
Where was he at the time?
He was in Copenhagen. He was in business school in Copenhagen. He was, I don't know how old he was. He's 34 now, so he's 6 years younger than I am. So I don't know, whatever. He was in college still, doing his thing, and he wrote back, and we traded some emails, and I really liked his help, and I ended up saying, I can't finish this product that I made, can you help me? And he was a PHP programmer at the time. He goes, sure, like, I'm a student, whatever. It's like, $20 an hour. I'm like, fine, $20 an hour. Bought 10 hours at a time. And he made this thing, we worked together. And we really,
hell of a deal.
It was. We really enjoyed working together, and so we did that project, and then I had him do some client work for us. We'd been hired by a credit union in Wisconsin called Summit Credit Union. They hired us to redo their intranet. I could do the interface, but I couldn't do the back end, and so David did the back end, and so we worked together there. And we just kept working together. Eventually, he got out of school. I hired him as an employee. It became very clear very quickly that he was...
Was he remote then, or was he?
He was still in Copenhagen. Yeah. He was there until, I don't know, 2006. Then he moved to Chicago, and now he splits his time in a few places. But it became clear that there was something extra special about him. And so at some point, I gave him a small piece of the business, and then he bought a little bit more, and then we kind of settled that out. But that's how that whole happened. So I started out as just 10 hours a week or whatever it was, and then employee, and then partner. I think that's an important lesson, especially for new founders who sometimes are obsessed with speed. They're like, I need a co-founder. Let me just find the programmer, because I'm a designer, let me find a programmer. Like, that'd be like marrying someone on the third date, you know what I mean? And that could work, but you gotta date a while, and that same thing is true for work. You gotta work with someone for a while, you gotta see how you guys see eye to eye when you butt heads. What's it like? Can you get over those differences? Like, what are your values? You got to understand all that stuff if you want to have a really good founder.
It's funny. You hear these things are like, hey, come meet your co-founder. And it does, if you think about it in those terms, it seems absurd.
It kind of does.
Go meet your wife and get married in an hour.
It works for some, right? So there's always examples you can point to. You go, see, it works. But I think in general, I mean, if you want to be in a business for long term, which is something I'm interested in, 20, 30, 40 years, hopefully, if we can last that long, you know, you got to make sure that your co-founder, and you're talking about money and business deals, like, this is really difficult to unravel if something goes wrong. So you want to make sure that you're in a good spot.
Well, it's obviously been a great partnership. Talk a little, how do you guys work together today? How has it evolved?
Oh, and also I should say that Ruby on Rails, which he invented, came out of Basecamp. So Basecamp was the first.
Let's go to that, because I think very, a lot of people know you all. The 37 Signals is the birthplace of Rails, but I don't think a lot of people know that Rails really came out of
Came out of Basecamp. So when David and I were talking about making Basecamp, he's like, he's a PHP programmer, and he's like, you know, I heard about this new language called Ruby. Can I write Basecamp in Ruby? I'm like, I don't know. Like, I don't know what Ruby is. I'm like, what if you die? Like, who's gonna finish it? Like, there's a million PHP programmers out there, but what if you die? He's like, I won't die. Don't worry. but it was interesting because at the time, some really people he really respected, programmers, were getting into Ruby. And I'm like, you know what? I've always believed that if you're going to ask someone to do work for you, they've got to be comfortable doing the work in their own way. And so if he wanted to write in Ruby, who was I to say that was a bad idea? He was the programmer, I wasn't. So I'm like, go ahead, write it in Ruby, what do I care? We didn't even know, again, if this thing was going to be big or not. We had no idea. But I'm like, go ahead, write it in Ruby. So I wrote it in Ruby, and after it was out, we started talking about making other products. And we realized that, like, there's a lot of stuff that we'd have to start over from, for a new product. We'd be repeating ourselves. We'd be, like, building the same account management system, and everything has records and searching and storing strings of text and all this stuff. And you gotta name your tables and name your columns, and you gotta, name your models and controllers and all this stuff. And he's like, he didn't say this, but he just pulled out the stuff from Basecamp and reused it for the next product. But that stuff that he pulled out of Basecamp, he packaged up, called it Rails, Ruby on Rails, and open sourced it. Because infrastructure, we always think, is better if it's open source. Our whole stack is built on open source software. Infrastructure software is a very challenging, complicated thing to do. It's better to have a lot of really smart minds working on it, and then everyone can benefit from it. So we open sourced it. We didn't know, again, what was going to happen. He's like, put it out, late 2004, the first beta, I think it was, and he did this silly demo of how to build a blog in 15 minutes using Rails, and it kind of went viral. I mean, there's no such thing as viral back then, but like it went around the programming community really quickly, and Rails was sort of taken off slowly, and obviously today it's a huge thing. There's economies built around it. There's businesses built around it.
Right, no, it's
But it was just a thing that we pulled out of Basecamp. So Basecamp technically was the first Ruby on Rails app ever made. And Basecamp still today is always on the latest version of Rails, which is Edge Rails, like the latest possible version before it goes out to the public. We're always running that version. So most major new features that end up in Rails start out in Basecamp still today. So that's our proving ground for Rails.
That's amazing. So
it comes back again to we're writing stuff in the framework that we need. We're not imagining what other people need. We have new needs. We're at new scale. We have new demands, and we build something in Rails, and then we put it, try it in Basecamp, and put it in Rails, and ship it.
And how about ideas you get for the framework from other people? How does that fit into the?
Well, there's a core team. I don't know how many there are now, 12 or something. I'm not sure. It's a core team. It's open source, so anyone can contribute. A lot of people do. Thousands of different commits from thousands of different people, and it's an open source product. But at the end of the day, David makes the final call on all those things. Because he's the person who started it, and that's how usually open source works.
That's amazing. Well, Rails has just taken off.
It's become a big thing, which is pretty wild.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it's huge.
Yeah. I think, part of it was we're in the right place at the right time. It was radically different and radically simpler and so easy for non-programmers to start programming. Like, it just opened up. It addressed this idea, Clay Christensen's idea of non-consumption, which is there's a lot of people out there who wanted to make stuff but didn't know how, and all the existing options were too complicated. And all of a sudden, there's this thing, you can make a blog in 15 minutes, and you can follow along with him in this webcast and like just type with him, and you have a blog. Mm-hmm. Like, wow, I could never have done that myself before. And all of a sudden, people are like, wow, this is cool, and it built from there.
That's really cool. So there's a theme going through all this that I just want to hit on for a minute, which is you have clearly the theme of simplicity is powerful, and you're well known for that. But, I hear again and again the theme also of, hey, let's share it.
Yeah.
You got Signal versus Noise.
Yeah.
You got the books you got. You guys are big share. Talk about why that is such a core philosophy of what you do. Because a lot of people would have never put the time into componentizing it and making it something to share.
I've always been inspired by chefs. Great chefs have cookbooks. They write not all of them, but many of them write cookbooks.
Sure.
And in the cookbooks are their recipes. And they're not afraid of someone taking their cookbook and opening a restaurant next to them and putting them out of business. What they're afraid of is not being known and not being recognized and not being appreciated. So by writing cookbooks, they can get their food out there. And in fact, more people will pay attention to their restaurant because they'll try and make the food. That's pretty good, but I know it's going to be better if this guy makes it or she makes it or whatever. And so chefs share the recipes, not all of them, but many of them. And I've always thought about how can we write our own cookbook? What's our cookbook? What are the things that we know how to make? that we can share and teach other people how to make, and we don't have to be worried that someone's going to put us out of business because they're following us exactly. That's just not, it's not how things are. So we've always felt that way. So Getting Real, one of our books, Rework, Remote, these are all our cookbooks on how we make things work here at Basecamp. And I just felt like, why wouldn't we want to put out more cookbooks?
So,
like,
so
I think about famous chefs, like, and popular chefs, right? They have many, many cookbooks. They open many more restaurants because of that. They get new, a lot of people pay more attention to them. They might get TV deals, like all the stuff. And all they're doing is sharing what they already know. Mm-hmm. It's like, why not do that everywhere? And businesses are terrified of sharing for some unknown reason. I don't understand why, but we don't want to be that kind of business.
So how'd you decide to write the first book, to go from signal versus noise to a book?
Well, blogs, so you have a blog, right? And there's a lot of hits and a lot of misses. And a lot of the stuff that came from the first, or went into the first book, which is called Getting Real, which is a self-published PDF, was just blog posts that we tweaked a little bit, but blog posts that we pulled out, we culled from the collection of things we'd written, and assembled it into a coherent whole, and sold it for $20 as a PDF. And we've sold over $1 million worth of those over the years. 2006, so it's been around for a long time. And now it's free, so anyone can read it. And I still think it's the best book we've ever written, our first book there. But it was just like, we had these things, we put these things on the blog, so why not package them up in a way that was more consumable? It's productizing, again, something that, you know, you could say, well, these are on the blog for free. Well, then go read them for free. That's fine. But a lot of people don't want to, like, go pick through stuff. They just want something.
Yeah, curate it for them.
Here's this thing. So we turn it into a PDF and put it out there, and there's no DRM. Our DRM solution at the time, this is the first time I'd ever seen this done before, so we're really proud of it, is we just printed the person's name at the bottom of every page saying this book was prepared for Sam Smith or something like that. And so if they shared it out, they'd feel a little guilty. That if it got out there, it would say who shared it. So that was fun. That worked pretty well. I don't know. Maybe people shared it. It didn't matter. But and then we did the same thing with Rework. So Rework was the culmination of a lot of other ideas that we had on the blog, which we then packaged into a book and refined and everything. Because we different people write on the blog, so we had to have a coherent voice, and so we did a lot of editing and that sort of thing, and put that out, and same thing with Remote. Although Remote was mostly new content, never published before.
So you have an interesting thing here, which is you have one outside investor.
Yes.
And talk about that and that story a little bit, as much as you're comfortable, because I think certainly Jeff Bezos is one of the most respected and famous people out there, but he's a bit of an enigma to the average person.
Yeah, so in 2006, we took one investment. It's the only investment we've ever taken. It wasn't really investment in the business. It was founder shares, like money off the table for me and David at the time. It was 2006. Basecamp had been doing well, but we had no idea if it was going to continue, and we wanted to take a little bit of risk off the table.
How'd you connect with them?
Well, we've been approached by dozens and dozens and dozens of VC firms. We didn't want VC money because we just didn't need it and didn't want it. We wanted to do things our own way. But then I heard from Jeff's office. So a woman who worked for Jeff, Elizabeth Carell was her name. Jeff had seen me speak somewhere. He liked what I had to say. One of the other companies that he invested in was using Basecamp. And then we'd done a website for another company that he bought. And so, like, there's this triangulation. And so I guess he told Elizabeth to get in touch with us. She got in touch with us. She's like, Jeff Bezos would like to meet you. I'm like, okay. Because, like, Jeff Bezos is a hero of mine. I love the guy. I have so much respect for what he's done. Of course, I would meet Jeff Bezos. Like, yes. So flew out to Seattle. But all the time, I'm like, I'm not taking any money from him. I knew it was an investment thing. I don't want anyone's money, but I'll go meet Jeff.
How cool.
How cool. Just how cool. Period. Just like how cool to meet Jeff, right?
Yeah.
So you go out and meet Jeff, and he walks in the room, and he's really a special person. You can see at the moment you meet him, he's just different than everybody else I'd ever met. Very smart. You could tell he was smart before he said anything. There's something about him. Very sharp, very clever, and he picked up on things so fast, faster than anyone I've ever met before. When you explain something to him, he gets it, and he sees, like, three stages out before you've even explained it to him, but you've been sitting there for like 3 months thinking this stuff through. He's like, oh, so then you'll probably do this next and this. And I'm like, yeah, how'd you know that? So he's very good. Anyway, so we were talking to Jeff about stuff, and I was so impressed by his knowledge and his experience and what he'd been through. And this was still kind of early for Amazon. I mean, Amazon had been around for a while, but he was like in the middle of it still. And I'm like, man, he must have learned so many things that he could help us with. And so we had set up another meeting. David came out this time. And we actually showed Jeff Campfire, which was our third product at the time. And he's like, oh my God, I totally get this. Like, all this stuff. Like, Jesus, how'd you get that so fast? He's got it, you know? And then we said, you know, we worked a deal out where he bought a small piece of the company. We don't share how much and what percentage, but it's a very small piece, non-controlling. We have no board, so there's no board seat. He can't force us to do anything. He just wants to be along for the ride and wants to help us if we have questions. So every year we get to talk to him as often as we want, but really it's like twice a year. Maybe we get to eat dinner with him like once every 2 years or something like that. But it's a great dinner. But he's always available to chat. Like if we need his time, we contact his people, and then like they set up a call, and he's always available if we need him. But we talk to him once or twice a year. And he's the most encouraged. It's interesting because I read the book about him. I don't know if anyone's read the book, The Everything Store. But he seems to be very difficult to work for. But he's been fantastic with us. He's very supportive. He's very enthusiastic and supportive. And maybe he just has a different thing with.
So talk a little bit about like when you sit down with them, like what's he like to have, what's Jeff Bezos like to have dinner
Jeff
with?
Jeff is a super curious person. And so he's very intense. And I don't know if you've ever heard his laugh, but it's crazy. He's got this loud laugh. And if anyone here uses Campfire, in your Campfire chat, if you do /play/Bezos, it'll play Jeff Bezos' laugh. So we do that. We do that all the time. Anyway, great laugh, very smart, very attentive, but also gets bored very quickly. So you lose his attention quickly if you're boring him. He's just not into it. He's not interested in being bored because I think he's like, I don't have time to be bored. I'm into so many interesting things. But not in an arrogant way. Mm-hmm. He checks out quickly. And so it's always cool just to talk about. I love talking to him about the things he's doing, more so than the things I'm doing. Because he's like going to space. That's cool. He's building a 10,000 year clock. So this is really cool. So he's building this 10,000 year clock in a mountain in Texas. And the idea is Jeff's a very long-term guy. That's his whole thing, long-term.
I would say so.
Yeah, and a lot of Wall Street always hates him because he's a long-term guy, long-term, long-term, long-term. He's like, I'm willing to be misunderstood for 8 years every time we do something new, like whatever. Long-term guy. So to prove that, he's like, I'm building a clock that has to function for 10,000 years, which is something humans have never done before. And so it's very precise, and he's funding this whole project. It has to be in a geologically stable place. So they found a mountain in Texas, in a mountain. But the most interesting thing about it was that it has to be regulated by the sun to stay perfectly timed, because it's possible that if there was like a nuclear war, like 10,000 years is a long time, like stuff can happen. And a lot of clocks are like, there's a ping that they attach themselves to get the right time. Like that could be gone, that service could, but the sun hopefully will be around. If the sun's not around, like bigger problems are going
on. And no one's gonna see the clock anyway,
right,
at that point.
So what's really cool is there's a little window at the top of this mountain that like looks at the sun occasionally and like gets. But the biggest challenge of building a 10,000 year clock is how to keep that window clean. That's the biggest challenge. Huh. It has to stay clean for 10,000 years because you can't depend on people being around to clean it. And it's in a remote location. So like just hearing like, and I don't know if they've solved the problem yet, but hearing him talk about how that's the problem and how he just goes into detail about it and all the things they've tried, it's fascinating. So
that's
love talking to him. I love listening to him more than talking to him. I feel like I have very little to say when Jeff's in the room. You know? But he's one of the most important things. I'll give you two things he told us business-wise, or actually one business-wise thing and one life thing. He said the most important thing in business is to figure out what's not going to change in your business and invest heavily in that. So a lot of businesses are focused on what's changing. Change, 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 change. But he says you should do the opposite. He gave me an example with Amazon. He said 10 years from now, people are not going to wake up and go, I wish Amazon selection was worse, right? So they're going to appreciate this now, they're going to appreciate Big Selection now and forever. So I can invest in Big Selection. People are not going to wake up 10 years from now and go, I wish Amazon shipping was slower. So they can invest in Amazon shipping now, and it'll always pay off forever, right? People are not going to wake up 10 years from now and go, I wish Amazon customer service was crappier, right? So let's invest in customer service. And so he's like, find those things that are never going to change and pour everything you have into those things. Hmm. And so for us, it's like, people aren't going to wake up 10 years from now and go, I wish Basecamp was slower. So we've invested heavily in performance and speed. Our app's very, very fast. People aren't going to wake up 10 years from now and go, I wish, you know, Basecamp's customer service was crap. So we've been investing heavily in that. Right now, if you email Basecamp support, you'll get a response in under 2 minutes.
Wow.
Some days under a minute. And that's like unheard of in terms of email response. We've invested heavily in that. That's a great experience. People aren't used to that. It's crazy. And then people aren't going to wake up 10 years from now and go, I wish Basecamp was way harder to use. You know, so we have to invest in making it simpler. A lot of people want more stuff, but so that's a trick. But you got to, like, fundamentally, people aren't going to want things to be harder to use. So those are the places we invest, and I believe in that a lot. So I think that's a great piece of advice. And he also said about life, he said, you don't find your passions find you. So when you ask, like, he's like, you know, I'm like, why are you into space? He's like, I don't know, space found me. And like, why are you into building a 10,000 year clock? He's like, I don't know, that concept found me. Like, he's really big into that if you don't know what you're really passionate about yet, don't search for it. It'll find you. And I thought that was a really good,
that is
good piece of advice.
Wow.
Really cool.
That is really cool.
Yeah.
So a little, we'll take some audience questions mm-hmm. here,
sure.
One of the little known facts, I think, by the average person is that you have been a longtime close friend and of Andrew Mason's.
Yeah.
And you were on the Groupon board, I think,
I was.
Pre-IPO.
Yep, I was. Then I was fired from the board. It's good. It was the right decision, by the way.
Yeah. So talk.
That was the right, totally the right decision.
So talk a little bit about, you know, your experience with Andrew, leave the
yeah.
public side out and all that.
Yeah,
but, you know,
yeah.
Like in the early days of doing that as a friend of his, an advisor,
yeah.
a board member.
Well, I met Andrew through a mutual friend, a guy named Scott Heiferman. Scott Heiferman started meetup.com. You guys know Meetup? We designed the first Meetup site. And Scott flew to Chicago to meet with us to pitch us on this thing. He's like, I got this idea called Meetup. It's like America offline. I'm like, oh, that's cool. And we talked about that. And so we designed the first Meetup site. And so I've known Scott for a long time. Scott's good friends with Andrew, because Andrew did this thing called The Point, mm-hmm. which Scott really liked. The Point was about raising money for a cause. And do you know the idea behind The Point, which is really cool? The story was, Andrew had this, because Andrew's crazy, like in all the good ways. He had this idea that maybe we could build a dome over Chicago if we could raise enough money. Like, if we could raise enough money to build a dome over Chicago, let's build a dome over Chicago. So he's like, that was the first project on The Point. It was like, donate money to build a dome over Chicago. So in the winter, it'd be warm here. Like, that was his thing. It's a crazy idea. Anyway.
I'm for it.
Yeah, right. Who wouldn't be? That was the thing. Like, who wouldn't be for that? You know. Anyway, so I met Andrew through Scott, and then Andrew was looking for a product person to join his board because his board was mostly made up of investors at the time and business folks, and he wanted someone to help with product advice, and I was in Chicago and he was in Chicago, so he had lunch and he offered me the slot, and I'd never been on a board before, and still the only board I've ever been on as far as a company goes. I'm like, sure, let's do it, you know? And it was a fascinating learning experience. Andrew is a really creative guy. I think he's a great leader, and I think whatever he does next, will be good. I feel like he's just the guy who knows how to make good stuff. And I think that whole thing just sort of got out of control at a certain point. And
sure.
It's very difficult, I mean, to run a company that grows that fast. If you have no experience, like, hardly anyone can do that.
Well, and you see,
he's a great guy.
I have to say, I'm amazed that people in the Valley always had they really had their knives out for Groupon.
Yeah, they did.
Unfairly so.
Yeah, I think so too. But I mean, the business model wasn't very sound, and they've had, you know, they're still figuring out how to make it all work.
Sure.
But I thought Andrew's leadership there creatively was awesome, and like his imprint is still on the company and everything. But he's a great guy. I love Andrew. He's fantastic.
Great.
Yeah.
So a couple questions before we wrap up here.
Yeah.
I take them by voting, so I'll just take them.
Oh, okay.
So the first question, the highest ranked question here is, WhatsApp or Instagram would never have generated much traction had they been found in Chicago. Agree or disagree?
Disagree. WhatsApp, I mean, where was that founded? Anyone know?
California.
Nope. Israel, right? I mean, Israel is a technical hotspot, actually. A lot of biotech work, a lot of technology, but it's not the valley. It's a lot of great products that don't come from a coast. There's a lot of great products that do. I think if the product's good enough and solid enough and you do all the right things, it can be successful anywhere.
So what, and then the follow-up is, and what, if anything, should change about our startup or VC culture to be on par with the East or West Coast?
Well, I don't think anything should, we shouldn't do anything to be on par with anybody. We should do what we, like, this isn't about being someone else. Chicago's got to be about being Chicago. And Chicago's never going to beat the Valley or the East Coast in terms of raising money. It's just not, that's not what this place is about. So I don't think we should try to do anything on par with them. We should do our own thing. You know? And what that is up for debate, but it's not trying to be like them.
Yeah. No, I think you got
to be. You can't be, trying to be like someone else, you're never going to be that person, right. Ever. You never can be. Right.
No, that's exactly.
So why? Why try?
Yeah, be authentically who you are. That's good advice.
Yeah.
So another question is up here, ranked high, is about the decision to focus on Basecamp and to name the company Basecamp.
Right, so a few weeks ago we announced that we were no longer 37 Signals, we're now Basecamp. So we're in the process of trying to sell our other products. Or if we can't sell them, we'll spin them off, and if we can't do that, we'll continue to run them. So we're making a commitment to our customers that we're not gonna leave them hanging one way or another, but we're trying to sell them, sell the products. Was the question why we do that?
Yeah, why focus just on Basecamp and why rename the company?
It's kind of a long story, but basically it's what we like to do the most. It's the product we like to work on the most, the product we use the most. It's what we know the best. It's what our customers like the most. It's what we mostly spend our time on anyway. And it all just made sense to us. Like, looking at the numbers, vast majority of our business comes from Basecamp. Vast majority of people who we ever meet know Basecamp more than anything else we've ever done. We think that it's our best idea. And I don't have any shame in saying, like, our best idea happened 10 years ago. And I may never have a better idea than Basecamp. That's fine if that's what happens. But I think it's still a great idea, and it's still doing exceptionally well. It's never been doing better, and we think that it has a very long life, that people will always be working together on stuff, and Basecamp's a great way to do that, and we want to focus all of our energy on that. It also helps with just the company vision internally and externally. Our Basecamp customers know we're in it for the long haul for them. Everyone who works at the company knows they're building Basecamp. Their job is to make Basecamp better, not like make one of five or six other things better. And I just found that we do our best work when we're focused rather than diluted. No one does their best work when they're stretched too thin. And we want to keep the fundamental thing here, we want to keep the company as small as possible. And that means that we have to say, we're not going to hire 40 more people to do these other 40 ideas. We're going to keep the team as small as we can, and to do that, we need everyone to focus on one thing, otherwise we're going to be spread too thin.
Great. And then follow on to that, there's some questions here that are a little, I think people who are, might be a little more narrow, a little groupie-esque, so we'll try and keep it on the ones that are big.
Whatever.
We had some funny ones last time, but the question was about the vision for Basecamp. Where do you take it from here? What's your, you know, what are the question was specifically about it was, what does the next 15 years look like?
Yeah. You know, we don't know. I mean, the idea is to help people make progress on projects together. And whatever that means, like, might change over time. New technologies will come out or new ideas will come out. But that fundamental idea still needs to be the driving force. So, I mean, we have a lot of ideas for where it could go, but we don't want to force any of those ideas. We want to just keep working on what we're doing, continue to simplify. I want the part to get simpler every year. Mm-hmm. To be simpler and more focused and clear every single year, which is the opposite of how most software works. Most software gets more complicated over time, gets crappier over time. Version 2 of something is usually, well, version 3 or 4 is probably the best, and then it just goes to hell, right? So I feel like we're in version 2 of Basecamp, and I want to keep it under 4, you know, in some ways, theoretically, and just keep it simple. So that's the idea.
And is there, as you think about scaling your product, how do you do that without scaling your staff?
What's cool about the business model behind Basecamp is it's self-service. So we could sign up another 100,000 customers tomorrow and not have to hire another programmer, another designer. We probably have to hire some more people in ops to run the servers, and we have to build that up. We probably have to hire some more customer service people. But we don't have like a one-to-one relationship. We don't have like account managers who can only manage 20 customers and we have to grow huge to handle another 100,000. It's very much a self-service setup, and we can keep the company really, really small as we add customers. I mean, our customer growth is, we have 15 million people now, who are not all paying customers, but who have Basecamp accounts. And you know, we're 40 some odd people. A lot of other companies have a 40 person design group, and they have fewer customers than us, and they're doing far less, they're not doing as well as we are. So I think that it's very easy to balloon a team and grow something big when you don't need it. So I like to keep the focus on keeping the team small rather than trying to build the team and then trying to have a product that fills the team, because that's when things get complicated.
Got it. Another question here is, you're famously known for your extremely focused and rigorous hiring selection process. How do you balance keeping hiring targeted versus taking on great talent that comes along unexpectedly?
Sometimes I feel like we definitely pass up on past people that we shouldn't, because they're really good, but we have nothing for them to do. Now, you can create work, but I think that's like really insulting. I think it's insulting to give people work that doesn't matter just to keep them busy so they're around for something else. I don't think that great people want to do that. I think great people want to contribute to something meaningful that matters. And if we just don't have the things for them to do, I don't want to hire them. But so we miss people, for sure. We miss people. But you know, maybe that person will be available again down the road. And if we need them again, maybe we'll see if they're around. One of our designers, we hired him, he left, and then 7 years later he came back. You know, so people, if you have a long time horizon, you don't worry too much about someone getting out of your way or losing someone right now, because maybe you'll pick them up in 5 more years when you need them again.
Got it. Couple last questions, then we have a follow-up. Sure. In your book, Rework, you disagree with failing forward as a way to encourage innovation.
In failing fast, maybe? I don't know what that failing is. Failure, I mean, I think failure is sort of, failure is something that the tech world seems to love to talk about. And I don't understand that. I don't think dry cleaners like to talk about failing. And I don't think restaurant owners like to talk about failing. And I don't think car dealers are excited when they fail. And like, I don't think bookstores are pumped up when they fail and they have to close stores. Like, what is it about the tech world that makes us all think that failure is good? And some people are like, well, you got to fail fast and fail often and all this stuff. I don't know. How about trying not to do that? Like, what is the story with this? Like, failure, like, is idolized. I don't understand it. So I think you should be trying to make something that's great and not plan on it going to hell. Like, make something that's great. And if you do, most businesses don't make it. So but you shouldn't go into it feeling like failure is going to be a great lesson for me. No, it's not as good of a lesson as succeeding.
What do you think of the whole lean startup movement?
I like the principles. I don't know all the rules behind lean startup, but I believe keeping companies small, building simple products to start. I think though that you got to understand what you're building. It's not enough to just build a simple product. You got to know the job that's being hired to do, and so it's like, if the goal is just to get to an MVP, but the MVP is not a good fit for anybody, then that's a crappy goal. Like, right. You got to get to the right fit. You got to understand the market. That should be the goal, and that's how you should build something, rather than trying to have this to achieve this state of an MVP. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But I like the spirit of it, for sure. I think it's better than a lot of the alternatives.
So the two last questions we ask everybody.
Okay.
One is thought on Chicago for startups. What's your thought on Chicago for startups generally and today versus when you started?
Well, it's grown a lot. There's a lot more energy here now. There's a lot more people here who are great. I don't think much about cities in terms of, like, is a city a good place to start a business? I think any place is a good place to start a business if you have a good idea and you have good people and you know how to do it. That said, what I love about Chicago is that the way I hope it sort of stays is that there's less immediate pressure to blow up and grow big. Instead, I think it's a very sound place to start a business. Costs are significantly lower than other places, and the people here are great. I'm from here, so maybe I'm biased, but Midwestern work ethic and just the type of people who are here, I think it's a lot of no bullshit people, which I like, and I think that's a great, healthy place to start a business. Also, we have a very diverse economy here, which is really good, I think, and a lot of really experienced business owners and all sorts of different industries, which I think is very healthy. But I think that you can start anything anywhere. I know so many great products. Like a great product that a lot of our customers use is something called Harvest. Harvest is a time tracking tool. Those guys are down in Florida. Another tool, SurveyMonkey, which is now, that was started in Portland, Oregon. A great mailing list service, MailChimp, is out in Atlanta. Another one's down in Australia. Like, these are fantastic products and fantastic companies, and they were started anywhere. And you can do that today more than ever before than you can ever do it before. So.
Good. You've been involved with some different startups with Starter League here a few months back. Talked about being the board early at Groupon.
Yeah.
When you think about, are there companies or entrepreneurs that you're really excited about, things you're seeing that you've been either exposed to or mentored that you're like, boy, that's cool. I think that'll be a great one.
I'm embarrassingly out of touch with what's going on right now, mostly because I've been focused on my own stuff. But as I get older and I really feel like I want to get more involved with mentoring. I have mentored
the Starter League guys because they really give you a lot of credit for wanting to do something with them.
Yeah, I met Neil. Neil came to our office for a JavaScript class at some point that we were holding, and I met Neil, and Neil read our books, and I was just super proud. If anyone here knows Neil Sales Griffin, he's like, how could you not be impressed by that guy? Crazy impressive. And so he liked what we were doing, and I liked him, and it just felt like a good setup to help. If I could, and so we are, and I do help. I help people who ask all the time. I respond via email to as many people as I can. I get people asking me questions all the time. But I think ideally it'd be really cool down the road for me to be involved with a couple people, three people, four people, and go really deep with them rather than like. I don't think you can really help someone via email. You know, it's very surface level. It's hard to do. I respond, but I'd really like to go deep with a few people who are really interesting. I'm not in the scene very much, so I don't really know what's going on. I don't know who's really interesting, but I'm certain there are very interesting things going on here.
Great.
Yeah.
Well, thanks for sharing your story, Jason.
You bet. Great to have you. Thanks, Pat. Thank you.